All right. Hello. I think I've hit the record button just right. welcome. Welcome, alum. This is a webinar that we were asked to do on fairy tales and children's literature. My name is Holly Blackford. I am a professor at Rutgers Camden of English and Communication, and I have been teaching fairy tales and folk tales for a couple of years now. Sometimes enrollment goes up to 75 people. There's a lot of interest in folk and fairy tales as they've manifested across ages and places. I thought after the alumni office asked me to do this today, it would be a little more fun if you weren't just looking at me. So I invited a colleague who's also a veteran teacher and librarian at Rutgers Camden to participate. And so we're just gonna go back and forth talking about fairy tales and why we think it's a good time for us to look back at fairy tales, particularly because they evoke very dark times and very dark themes. So my friend and colleague Vibiana Cvetkovic is going to help me out today. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Hi, everybody. I'm Vibiana Bowman Cvetkovic. I'm a librarian emerita from Rutgers University, which means I'm a retired librarian. And I have a PhD in childhood studies from Rutgers University. So I am also an alumna. Holly was my dissertation advisor. My dissertation was on children and television. And I am currently teaching children's literature and English composition at Atlantic Cape Community College.
And let me ask this before we start. My students, when they come to the fairy tale class, are very surprised and appalled at the older versions of these tales and how dark they are, and the fact that they were for children and families and everybody in the community. They're often, so appalled. They prefer the sort of more sanitized versions that we know today. Are your students the same? Do they react with horror when they see sort of evil queens having to dance in fire shoes until they die, and stepsisters cutting off heels to fit in Cinderella's shoes? Do you have the same reactions that I get?
Well, my students are traditionally aged college students for the most part. So they're mostly born like in the 2000s and forward, and 2000 and forward. And I think that they have grown up with the adaptations of the fairy tales rather than the actual original tales themselves. And while the Pixar and the Disney adaptations are very rich and have meaning and substance in their own way, yes, I would say finding the source material and sort of the darkness, the depth, the range of feelings that they contain are also often surprising for students. And I think it's interesting for them to realize that fairy and folk tales are a genre and are not just kind of bound into this very strict sort of structure of what is children's entertainment. And I think, Holly, you and I have often talked about that with other forms of visual literary culture that are now considered children's mediums, which is only a modern invention, things like puppet theater, which actually were for the broad community.
And originally, stage play as well. Like Peter Pan was originally a stage play that everybody would go to. So the idea that we've separated children's media from adults' entertainment is modern and new. So we're going back to a different time. Let me first show you our title slide and some of the illustrations that Vibiana pulled together, just so we can sort of look at what we're going to be talking about here. I'm new to WebEx and I'm working my way. So this is our title slide. We're calling this In the Darkness, Fairy Tales and Children's Literature. But I subtitled it on a more optimistic note, because what we're really going to be emphasizing is that fairy tales, with their darkness, with abandoned children in the forest, with children prey to wolves, with children whose step-parents just want to eat their hearts out, all of these unfortunate predicaments that fairy tale characters find themselves in are very dark. But what we really have through these tales is resiliency and resourcefulness. Even if you have to work your way through the wood with breadcrumbs, finding a house that you can eat and then having to kill the owner. These are things that just have to happen in fairy tales. And they're very poignant for what we're going through today. Here are some of the illustrations. This is Hansel and Gretel when they first come to see the witch with her very delicious house that they feel they have full rights to. Here we have, unfortunately, grandmother looking a lot like the wolf. Grandmother has been eaten by wolf, and Little Red Riding Hood, or Riding Cap in some versions, has to cope with that new situation. Here we have Snow White fleeing some horrors into the forest. And by the way, I love the scene in Disney where the forest is represented in its full scariness with eyes popping out at her. I think that's a very wonderful, terrifying adaptation scene. Here we have Cinderella making do with very little. This is the resourcefulness that we can find in our protagonists. Here we have Rapunzel, who is very relevant for where we are all today, sheltering in place and feeling like she did, that protection is also incarceration. So, you know, that's definitely an experience we can all relate to. What is this one, Vib?
That's Rumpelstiltskin. That's a recent illustration from a retelling of Rumpelstiltskin.
Yeah, and she's in a terrible position because her father has boasted that she can spin gold, and therefore she's kind of a coveted object by the king and needs to get help from Rumpelstiltskin, who, by the way, I always thought was completely justified in wanting her firstborn. She did make a bargain, but we'll get to that. And this is The Little Mermaid, is that correct?
That is correct. That is that's a French illustration, Duloc, his interpretation of Little Mermaid.
Mermaid was my tale when I was four through about seven. That was my favorite, the original by Hans Christian Andersen, where some very tough sacrifices and choices have to be made. And it doesn't end incredibly happily for her. Here we have Beauty and the Beast. This is Cocteau's version, La Belle et la Bête, which is a fantastic version that emphasizes his beastly nature, his difficulty coming to terms with how beastly he really is, which is a little different from the original tale that we'll look at. And here's an illustration of the Velveteen Rabbit. What we're hoping to do is look a little generally at the oral folk tales, which are a very living mode of storytelling, very interactive. And then we'll move to the literary fairy tales. And then if there's time, we'll discuss the Velveteen Rabbit a little bit, which Vib and I have had many interesting conversations about. So let me go back to just us. Seems very, the button you have to push to go back is stop sharing, which I think is difficult for me to push.
In more ways than one.
I don't like to stop sharing. That's just not in my nature. I like to share. So again, we call this In the Darkness, Fairy Tales and Children's Literature. And for the first thing we want to kind of talk about is the situation of the fairy tale amongst our ancient folk roots. Now, fairy tales, you know, were very alive at this time. A teller would gather people in the community around a fireplace, around the hearth, and do a very performative, you know, kind of spin on whatever folktale they were going to do. It was very interactive. the children or the people in the community could say, you know, what's going to happen next? Or no, that didn't really happen. And there would be sort of an interactive performance between the teller and the children involved. In modern times, the hearth really hasn't gone away. We just changed its form, right? The television, the internet, other kinds of hearths. You know, a lot of people, in fact, have their television either above their fireplace or where the fireplace would be. I don't have a fireplace, which always makes my children upset. How is Santa going to get in? But we do certainly have a large screen TV where we gather for our modern storytelling. Viv, do you want to comment on that? I know you've done the history of television, which was first marketed as a kind of storytelling gathering place, a hearth, if you will.
Well, I think when we were preparing for this, one thing I started to think about was, of course, you know, we keep referring back to the where we are right now in this moment of history and this, you know, big social experience experiment of self-isolation. And it's like, I think that looking backward and thinking about tales in times of darkness and in times of despair, which have happened over and over and over in human history, the family or the clan would gather around and, you know, pre-technology or, you know, in ancient times, we would gather around the fire. For the fire was literally warmth, but also emotional and psychological warmth. And the storyteller, often an elder or a grandma or, you know, the elder grandfather, would share the tales of the past, of the ancestors, of the ghost stories, the cautionary tales. So if you think of the oral tradition of fairy tales, they're not monolithic, but they are they encompass a large number of genres, from horror tales, which you can find a plethora of horror tales in Grimm that would modern folk, including myself and Holly, would think are completely not appropriate for children, to the fantasy and the lighter ones. So in this age of quarantine, I think the streaming services that we watch on our TV, most particularly, I think Netflix, I do think we can point to Netflix. And Netflix is our story sharing venue right now. And if you look on Netflix, you have the whole gamut, just like folktales. You have the histories, the documentaries, where have we been as a people? There's a lot of documentaries about pandemics right now because people want to look back and understand. Children's shows, horror shows, fantasy shows, you know, romance. So I think humankind constantly has the same impulse, the same psychological impulses, and the need for psychological nourishment and reassurance. It's just we keep changing the venue for the storyteller.
Netflix is definitely a communal experience. It is considered a big sin to watch an episode without the people you were supposed to be watching it with, right?
Cheat watching.
I was caught doing that, and I left it up on my computer, and I how it actually, Netflix will pause wherever you were, and I couldn't really cover that up, so I got in trouble for going ahead, right? So, you know, while people say the digital age can be isolating or what have you, it really is connectivity in the same way it's always been. And it does nourish the psyche to have this hearth. So we're gathering around my WebEx hearth here to have a kind of fireside discussion of why these tales are dark and why the more original source material is important. I say more original because we don't know originals at all. Because fairy tales were such an oral tradition, because they changed, you know, through repetition and innovation over time and place, we can't say that's an original or that's an original. There is work done about which might be a parent tale of different versions, but it's almost impossible to say, oh, this was the first one. So the word original doesn't have a lot of meaning, but that's okay. We're following here. You know, when I was first asked to do this, I thought about doing what I do for students, which is a critical approach thing. And then I scrapped that and I said, really, what we want to talk about is a kind of approach that was advanced by Runel Bettelheim to fairy tales. Mid-century, but parents were concerned about whether these tales were appropriate for children. And he came out, he wrote the book, The Uses of Enchantment. And whatever you think of Bettelheim himself, the book is useful because it takes a stand saying that darkness in children's fare is really psychologically nourishing and important. It voices a lot of insecurities, anxieties. You know, we all sometimes feel abandoned. We all feel neglected. We all feel challenged by very few resources. We all feel we might be subject to the arbitrary rules that are being placed upon us, like make sure you get home by midnight, by the third stroke of midnight, or what have you. All of these things are symbolic manifestations of things that we feel, and they actually work a little more effectively in a kind of symbolic realm where we aren't directly addressing the issues, but we're kind of performing them in a ritual theater, if you will. So one of the first ones that we thought we would talk about, because it's really dark, is Hansel and Gretel. Hansel and Gretel is dark. Imagine being put out in the forest by your parents because they just don't want you anymore, right? Ah, but it may not be. It may not be that parents don't want you. The tale can respond to so many things. It can respond to our sense of not having enough resources and having to make some tough choices. It can respond to our sense that our parents can't help us always, especially with our deep-seated fears and anxieties. It also suggests that we need to develop our own resources to get out of tough situations. So basically what we have here is Hansel and Gretel, brother and sister, which makes them quite a team, are put out by their father and, in some versions, mother, in some, stepmother. Whether that makes a difference or not is kind of up to you. It's a little more horrifying when it's your own mother who says, yeah, sorry, there's just not enough going on in this house, so either we starve or get rid of our children. So they do, but the children are not defenseless. They have a plan. Hans has a plan for how to get back. In fact, they get back and the parents put them right back out again. And the next time, you know, the resources are a little harder, the breadcrumbs are eaten by the birds, but they find a house in the forest, and it's very much a fantasy of the situation that has just occurred to them. It's an inverted place. It's a place of abundance, a place where they can just start eating a house indiscriminately. They just start devouring a witch's house. Now, that's always a dangerous thing. A plethora of resources, places, gold and enchantment and fairy tales often are dangerous. And so they get into trouble and they have to get out of that situation as well. But they are empowered to do so. One of the things Vib and I like about that story is that it actually is rather feminist. It's Gretel who comes up with the idea of putting the witch in the oven and saving her brother who's been in a cage being fattened up to be eaten. Both of them are trickster characters, and tricksters are a really big, important part of fairy tales. What's your take on Hansel and Gretel? We have a lot of movies that are about Hansel and Gretel as kind of action adventure, witch hunters and things like that. They've become kind of an interesting team. What's your take on those? And my dog just came.
It's okay. We're all gonna have cats and dogs wandering by when we do WebEx. It's part of the storytelling experience. It's part of the organical. It's interesting, as I was thinking about these different tales as we were preparing for this, I was thinking that Hansel and Gretel is probably one of the most widely known, right up there with Cinderella and Snow White. And yet, Disney Productions never essayed a feature-length film on the topic. And it's just because the elements, I think, are too hard to push into the constraints of a protected romantic childhood and the sort of cultural artifacts that we give our children, or our children's cultural popular culture. Even children, you know, when they did Snow White, it was the 1930s, but they managed to take some of the more disturbing, and we'll be talking about Snow White, take more of the disturbing elements and sort of manage them and curate them. And it was the same later in the, was it 1980s with Little Mermaid, 1989-ish or something? The really tragic element was deleted. But with Hansel and Gretel and film adaptations, there's been short cartoons, if I'm not mistaken. There's a hilarious Bugs Bunny cartoon about Hansel and Gretel. The thing, if you think about Hansel and Gretel, well, there's in Grimm, there are a lot of women protagonists, the women who solve the problem, save the person. And in Hansel and Gretel, you have sort of a triangle of women. You have the mother in some versions, stepmother in other versions, who basically sacrifices the children so that she and the husband can stay alive. You have Gretel herself, who solves the problem and saves the day. And then you have the witch, who is an evil cannibal. However, one could say that, the children did transgress upon her space, not that eating them is necessarily the correct punishment for the crime.
That happens a lot in fairy tales, is that it's like an eye for an eye. There's a sense of justice, right? You eat my house, I can eat you.
that's a balance of nature, isn't it? You eat my house and I eat you. Okay. And the two male characters, I mean, Hansel is endearing. Hansel is resourceful too, because he tries to trick the mother. He has breadcrumbs, he has rocks, right? But the father is so weak-willed. The father character is so much the antithesis, I think, of what we, perhaps modern sensibility, expect a father character to be. The other thing you and I, Holly, talked about in prepping for this was how the vulnerability, now these are centuries old tales. So, however, one can't deny that love and caring for one's children is deeply encoded into our DNA. And yet the mother or the mother figure in the story is under duress. It's like a Darwinian thing. There is only such limited resources. And if they care for the children, they will die. So, and I think maybe for a modern audience, it's perhaps hard to realize the great deprivation and the great terrors of, let's say, the 16th, 17th century, where wolves were a real threat. Wolves roamed the forest, wolves ate easy prey, such as children. There were repeated famines, repeated plagues. So terror and horror were a day-to-day event. And that's the thing I think that Hansel and Gretel really speaks to, the terror that our ancestors would feel, especially in the night.
And then I think also the need for children to be on their own and to develop their inner resources. If we don't take the story too literally, they have to develop their inner resources and their intergenerational powers in order to develop and learn that they can handle this thing themselves. The parent, by the end, mom is dead, just says she died when they returned. So again, there's that sense of poetic justice, right? So she's dead. But what's bothered me about that story is father never really apologizes. He's overjoyed. And now he's rich because they took all the gold from the witch's house, right? So things worked out really well for him. And it does say he never had a moment's peace having, put his children in the forest to die. So apparently he has some kind of a conscience. But yeah, and I think what you're pointing out is really important. We have to imagine the situation of absolute lack of resources and horrors. You know, there's a lot of women's writers focus on these fairy tales and how they might be relevant to today, particularly the ones with female protagonists. And it's true that women do have major roles in fairy tales. They, you know, they're whether they're witches or godmothers or stepmothers, there's many of them, and they tend to be incredibly resentful toward the next generation coming at them. And it's not so much literal, right, as it is a kind of intergenerational cycle of displacement, guilt at displacing parents, which can manifest itself as a kind of hostility toward parents in tales, right? Bruno Bettelheim points out that Hansel and Gretel, from a kind of psychoanalytical point of view, may not be about parents wanting to get rid of kids. It might be kids' feelings that their parents don't want them, that they're a burden, right? And that's how the tale could be understood in a psychic way, right? These are not to be taken quite so literally. One of the women writers who has worked on Little Red Riding Hood quite a bit is Angela Carter, with her stories in The Bloody Chamber. I wanted to read her first paragraph on one of her Little Red stories, because she tries so hard to contextualize the time of darkness in which these tales make sense. So she starts her tale, The Werewolf, in this way. She says, "It is a northern country. They have cold weather. They have cold hearts. Cold, tempest, wild beasts in the forest. It is a hard life. Their houses are built of logs, dark and smoky within. There will be a crude icon of the Virgin behind a guttering candle, the leg of a pig hung up to cure, a string of drying mushrooms, a bed, a stool, a table. Harsh, brief, poor lives." And she starts her story. She sets that up to make us realize, you know, being sort of confined with scariness all around you, wolves, plagues, you know, terrible things. You're in one room with a table, a candle, right, and your family. Something we can relate to, but also realize the urgency of these tales. Now, Little Red Riding Hood is one of my absolute favorite tales as well. And that story has always seemed to me incredibly cruel to the young people, much like Hansel and Gretel, in which a little girl is thrown into a situation with the absolute worst possible device, a red hood, into the forest. Now, we should all relate to this, because we cannot go out without masks and hoods, and it is still terrifying. But imagine the least camouflageable object being put on your head to signal, it's supposed to signal that she's a beloved child, but it really attracts predators. It really attracts notice to wear this hood. So I've always wondered why mom thought it was a good idea to send Little Red out to Granny's with some precious resources and a bright red hood that says, "Hey, here I am, little girl vulnerable in the forest, come get me." That just suggests too that the story of Little Red Cap, Little Red Riding Hood, depending on which version you look at, is also about intergenerational conflict, questions about, you know, who's supporting the future generation and who's keeping it back, and again, the resourcefulness of Little Red. Now, Jack Zipes published a version in France that predates Perrault. And it actually has Little Red getting out of her own situation, right? So instead of being blamed for straying from the path, she actually is empowered. She strays from the path, gets in trouble, gets to grandma's house. Grandma's been eaten. She does her strip tease, right? Take off this, take off that. Okay, it's really the wolf. You know, clearly it's a metaphor for other kinds of predators in the world. But in the original, she seems to be out of the situation herself. She says to the wolf, "I have to make caca, right? I have to go to the bathroom." He says, "Okay." She goes out to the forest. He insists that she have a rope tied around her leg. She goes out. She swiftly ties that thing to a tree and takes off, right? So she's a trickster. She actually gets out of it herself. Now, the men who collected the stories, Perrault and the Grimms, they didn't give her that same kind of agency at the end, which is kind of a mistake, but the effect is similar. The end of Perrault is she's just dead. She was eaten by the wolf. My students hate that. They hate this. What do you mean she's just dead? It's not a happy ever after ending. It's a cautionary tale. Don't go into the dark forest with a bright red hood and expect everything to turn out well. Now, the Grimm's version has the huntsman, introduces the huntsman to save her. And then some versions even have a later second problem with the wolf where grandmother and Red have learned better. And they actually, I think they fill his belly with stones, having learned to do so from the huntsman. I think that's how it works. What is your favorite version, Bib, and why do you like it?
I don't know. I don't really have a favorite version. Little Red Riding Hood, I think in very many ways is a deeply disturbing story. And when I have taught it, I think my students were sort of, I don't know if bemused is the right word, or when one first looks at it from sort of, if you use like a psychoanalytic sort of interpretation and analysis, the sexual dynamics that can be read into it are just sort of, it's kind of a disturbing tale. No matter how she, if she triumphs and lives at the end, or she gets devoured and, you know, that's it at the end. But I think, I don't think that psychoanalytic literary theory has put that meaning into it. I think it sort of just sort of uncovered it, because I think that tale has always been a cautionary tale about sex and sexual behavior, and about sort of the corralling or the containment of young women. I think there's a corollary, a strong corollary between Red Riding Hood and Hansel and Gretel, in that I think one could interpret part of Hansel and Gretel, in addition to agency and all that, is a bit of cautionary tale about unbridled passions, and often eating is code for unbridled passion, like eating and drinking in particular. And the children, you know, although they were starving and one could forgive them, there's a symbolic element in Hansel and Gretel to them, you know, eating voraciously, because it's it transgresses boundaries. And the same thing with Little Red Riding Hood is Little Red Riding Hood. I guess the reason the tale always disturbs me is that the tale, no matter which version, has this undercurrent that Little Red Riding Hood needs to be threatened or put in her place or contained in some way. She's definitely contained when she gets eaten by the wolf. She's contained in the belly, right? But her transgressive behavior is, although given, she was given by her mother the bright red hood, and you and I have talked about that, that the bright red hood is sort of the signifier of desirability, but she strays from the path, literally, of her own volition, and gathers up the wildflowers in great, I guess one could argue too that this voraciousness for beauty could be part of a limiting thing, that this is a cautionary tale about, instead of gathering a few, she gathers bundles, right, of flowers for the grandma.
Right, greed is
thank you.
In tales, and I mean, Gretel, I was looking at that the other day. It is greed. I mean, when they get to the witch's house and start eating it, the witch, at first, all you hear is a voice inside going, "Who is eating my house? Who is eating my house?" And
mothers of teenagers can relate to that. Who is eating my house?
Desperately stocking frozen pizzas for my teens. They ate for 2 days. So I understand this, you know, but while she's asking this question, the children's like lie and say, "Oh, you know, it's nobody." And meanwhile, Gretel pulls off a window pane and starts just chowing down on it, you know? So greed is, you know, like you're saying, a cautionary tale to being greed is really being anti-communal, right? A lot of these are about punishments for not being true to community. Little Red's been lifted out of the ordinary from her community, and that's why she's kind of prey, right? She's like the spoiled child, right? They spoiled her so much, they had to give her this hood. But it's very disconcerting. A lot of these tales are sort of promoting a kindness toward community, a kindness toward nature, keeping your virtue no matter what happens, keeping faith in bargains. It's a big problem when you abandon a bargain that you made, right? So both Rapunzel and Rumpelstiltskin are about bargains that were supposed to be sound, right? Things were stolen, bargains were made. And when the bargain is sort of violated, terrible things are going to happen. So the social contract is also part and parcel of these tales. Thinking about Snow White, which is another sort of oppressed child abandoned in the forest, which seems to be our theme of the day, abandoned by those who should care about you. But again, what we discussed is that Snow White makes her own way. She makes her own way. She makes her own family. She's actually, in the Grimm original, when she finds the dwarf house, she's not finding a place that's a mess that needs her to clean it, like in the Disney version. It's actually a very tidy little house. And then finding her there, she winds up taking food, kind of like any other fairy character who comes along and finds a place with food. She indiscriminately eats all the food as well. She takes a little bit from each of the 7 plates so that they won't really notice that much is gone. And of course they do notice right away. They're actually very careful housekeepers. But then they make a bargain that if she, keeps house for them, they will protect her. What's your take on Snow White? I've always been kind of interested in not only the inner generational dynamic, but also in there's some emphasis on the witch there being a little bit of a victim in terms of ideologies of beauty and youth being valued, whereas she and the evil queen is going to be replaced. So she has her own motivations for wanting to. In the original, she wants to eat the heart of Snow White. Again, there's a lot of this poetic justice of eating, but eating seems to be her way of staying young or ingesting the sort of energy of youth. I know Disney went that way with Tangled in Rapunzel, took her as a kind of eternal youth for Mother Gothel. But in the original Snow White, it really is true. She wants to eat her heart just to maintain her youth.
Well, there's an old joke about Snow White that it's like, women, as you read the tale of Snow White as an older woman, it's like, well, maybe the evil stepmother wasn't quite so evil, I kind of get that,
Before Botox, right?
Snow White's another one. It's an interesting tale, but again, as we were as prepping for this, thinking about this, and getting back to Bettelheim says that children in particular find these tales comforting and interesting psychological tools for working through their world, because in so many of the tales there's a moral clarity, that the figures are archetypes, that lots of times they frequently don't even have names. It's just the beauty or the prince or the princess. But in the tales we're talking about today, I think there's a lot of moral ambiguity. I think there's definitely a moral ambiguity in Hansel and Gretel. I mean, yes, we can all agree cannibalism is bad, right? But greed is bad as well. And with Little Red, yeah. And the same thing with Little Red Riding Hood, disregarding societal norms can lead to catastrophe, can lead to tragedy, right? And with Snow White, it's Snow White gets duped by the evil stepmother disguised as a witch several times. it's, well, help me remember, it's the comb before the apple. There's a comb, there's a corset.
Yeah, the first laces. She, and you know, when I read this with students, we can't really help wondering why Snow White is so stupid in these scenes.
Well, I was going to say that, but not in quite those words.
It's like, come on, like, she's been told shelter in place by the dwarf. Okay.
They're don't like, let don't, that peddler in. Don't let the Instacart person in.
Sure, right. She's like, she's kind of like this proto consumer, right? Like every item that the witch brings her attracts her because they're all sort of middle class up, you know, aspiring up, except the apple, but the laces, right? She brings the laces and they're so tight, Snow White falls down. And then the next thing is the comb, the poison comb. And again, the dwarves are like, stop opening the door. She does. But that's also the thing about it. The admonition is important. You're warned to do something. And once you're warned to do it, it's exactly the thing that you don't, you have to do it. You have to do it because that's human nature, right? Like, don't eat of that tree. Don't open the door. Don't do this. You know, be home by midnight and like, oh no, it's now the clock is striking. Oh, gotta go. Right.
Well, with Snow White, I think, a modern interpretation, a modern point of view, it's certainly different from when the tale was first told, but it's like, I get annoyed at her naivete. It's like, she keeps getting a chance to learn this lesson. And she doesn't learn the lesson. She will not learn the lesson. And I think that is also, you could again fold it into Little Red Riding Hood, sort of this cautionary tale for young women is don't be tricked. Don't be, you know, retain your innocence, but don't be overly naive. You have to know how to navigate the world so that no harm comes to you and listen to the people. The dwarfs, I guess, in this instance, it would be a paternal figure, you know, and they're telling her and yet she doesn't listen, not out of evilness, but again, one could say perhaps a greed, like a certain amount of greed in that, oh, that's pretty, or I want it, or the comb's so nice. Mm-hmm. And it's like impulsive behavior, a kind of impulsive behavior that a child might have. But when you become a woman, you have to curb that impulsive behavior. You can't eat the witch's house. You can't stray off the path, and you can't let peddlers that you don't know into your home.
Right. A lot of these are really preparation for life. And I think what's poignant about more of the original tales, Little Mermaid is a case in point here, is that tough choices are made, that the children are presented with choices and tough situations, and they have to make really hard choices. I really, you know, let's go into just the Little Mermaid here, which of course was my tale, so, you know, I get a little bit personal about, like, I like the Disney film up to a point. I really love how they created the sea world. I love how they use the sisters, very similar to the original tale. I love the sea witch. I think she is fantastic. Her song cuts through like femininity and how it works. I love it. I also love the fact that they have the mermaid have a statue of the prince, and that's in the original tale too, where she you know, really above the sea is her desire, right? She's a desiring girl. She, unlike her sisters, wants to go up. They all get to go up on their 15th year and look and experience the sky and the earth. But most of them just go, okay, that was fun, and come home. And she doesn't want to. She really wants to go there. So, you know, it's female desire. This is a female tale. But when things do not work out for her, the original has presents her with a really tough choice. First of all, going to above ground requires a lot of pain. She will always feel pain in her feet. In fact, her feet are bloody using them. She's also lost her voice. It's a little more violent in the original how that occurs. It's not like stored in a shell somewhere. And because she cannot get the prince this way, right? She's kind of an object when she's on land. In fact, she follows him around like a little page. Once he marries, her sisters come back and they say, we've made a new bargain with the sea witch. We've traded our hair for this new bargain. And the bargain is, you can return to us if you take this dagger and kill the prince. She does think about it. There's this wonderful, you know, moment where she's got the dagger above the prince, right? And that would be betraying your fairy tale nature. You're not allowed to do that. Protagonists are always sort of one with nature. She cannot do that. So she throws it into the sea and becomes sea foam. And then there's this kind of weird celebratory resurrection of her as sea foam. She can still earn her soul, but it will take 300 years and she's got to go around like punishing bad children and applauding good children, and she can earn her own soul. But so it's a tragic, terrible story of martyrdom and sacrifice, especially for a man. So like feminists might go, ew, but she has to make a tough choice. The point is she is empowered through these social contracts to make that choice. And she stays pure to herself. And then she's got a different kind of ending, a different kind of journey. But I think that's really important that these characters are not always rescued, that they do have to make their own choices and that they are empowered to do so that way. One of my favorite things to do with my students is do millions of versions of Cinderella and just pile them on and let them sort through what is this tale really about. You know, many of them think it's about getting the prince, and it's so much bigger than that. He's kind of a reward for her journey to wanting a different world. The one that we've inherited in our country is a specific one, but if you go way back into like the Chinese Cinderella, for example, you have a much different agentic kind of journey. It's usually, the Chinese one's called Yeshen. She is kind to a fish. She sort of takes her oppression, her very little food, and shares it with a fish. And the fish becomes her kind of spirit guide, returning her kindness to nature, right, in kind. So, I mean, you know, in other words, the character, it's important to go back to the originals because of the choices and the agency that these characters have.
I've always loved Little Mermaid. It's one of my favorites, the original Hans Christian Andersen. I guess I especially loved it when I was a teenager, and I guess because I loved the tragic love aspect of it, you know, it was very sort of Wuthering Heights almost, sacrifice all for love. But I think about Little Mermaid as based on some really ancient tales. I mean, there's, I think in almost every country that borders the sea, there's some sort of tale about a mer creature, a mer woman that falls in love with a human, or the other way around. And the sacrifices that person makes, the transformation and the sacrifice of the transformation. And it doesn't always end happy. And I think with Little Mermaid, particularly, the way Hans Christian Andersen wrote it down as a literary fairy tale, is that it speaks to transformation, and I think it also resonates with the idea of the outsider. The Little Mermaid has her own world, the under the sea world. She longs for a different world, but in that world, she's a complete outsider, and she's completely disenfranchised, no voice. A painful movement. And although I think one could see it through a feminist light, if you consider, you know, the story arc of Little Mermaid as almost a hero quest, with the mermaid as the hero. And her quest is, she throws away everything in her quest for love. Everything, you know, her family, her life, her voice, everything. And it is not imperative on the prince to return that, because she has made these choices and made this great sacrifice, it doesn't transfer that the prince will automatically buy into that bargain and into that choice. He wasn't part of that bargain. That was her choice. Okay. So even though she becomes, you know, she at the very end, it's tragic, but is it? Because she realizes she becomes seafoam. She has no soul, so she can't ascend into heaven, but she can go through yet another journey and transform and into even a greater version of herself, the completely spiritual version of herself, once she has gone through this fire of this kind of earthly desire. She sheds the mortal self and transcends.
It's not quite as different as the Undine story that predated the Little Mermaid, the Undine story of a mermaid or elemental water spirit. Because her prince is not true to her, she has to kill him. So she does.
Dang.
I like to use that phrase too. It's a nice way to think about it. Little Mermaid made a different choice. Undine. So, you know, Undine, her prince, her husband, and marrying him gave her a soul, looking good. But instead, he falls for someone else, betrays her, and by the rules of elemental spirits and justice, she has to kill him. She comes out of the fountain on his wedding night and kisses him to death, sucks out his life, but she's very, very sad about it. She's a figure of the weeping woman, weeping over the fickleness of men, and thereby becomes an interesting kind of icon of, you know, of sacrifice and weeping, but it becomes its kind of own poetics. It's kind of lovely. I think we're probably out of time. I can't believe how much we can get out of just a few tales. We didn't even get to all that we wanted to discuss, but you know, we had thought about doing the Six Swans, which is about a girl whose brothers are turned into swans, and the deal is she has to create their shirts. Is she knitting them? Is she weaving them?
She weaves them together out of flowers, out of an aster.
And for how many years?
Takes her 6 years. One year per brother. And she doesn't finish the least.
She can't speak while she's working on these to save them. And even though she's assaulted many times and asked to speak and defend herself, she does not. She is going to spend 6 years weaving these cloaks for her brothers and save them. So we have many, many, many images of heroines, heroes who persevere despite really horrendous and yet arbitrary conditions of power imposed on them. These were tales of the people. They were tales of you know, of people in dire circumstances. Often you have sort of common folk hero and heroines who are going against kings and lords and feudal system and stuff. So they're very empowering. They're very gritty. We prefer the gritty versions, and it would be fun to compare them with the adaptations that we have today. But we wanna stress that they are very nourishing ways to respond to the darkness, and they are very healthy ways to think about serious choices, bargains, social contracts, perseverance, determination, and ingenuity that allow these usually young characters to persevere, even if it means, you know, making the old folks who created the situation dance in iron fire slippers to our deaths. Well, they are about, and even if they eat us out of house and home, right? The point is that we cannot bail them out of all situations, that they have to actually figure things out themselves oftentimes. And that's really the lessons that we kind of wanted to draw out in this webinar today. Any last words, Vib?
Well, I was just going to say, everything that we did talk about today had a very strong female protagonist, or at least a female protagonist at the center of the action. And I think one thing they all have in common is they illustrate that there's a difference between innocence by virtue of virginity and age versus virtue. And virtue is a harder thing to come by. Cinderella in the Cinderella stories is virtuous. She does not retaliate. She perseveres through. She doesn't go against any bargains. She's sorry she was late getting home. She almost missed curfew. But she's a virtuous person, as is the princess in the Six Swans. Great virtue under duress. And again, as you said, Holly, it's something we can aspire to in dark times.
So thank you so much to our Rutgers community and to our alumni office and to our wonderful alum out there who continue to stay connected with us, who continue to make our intellectual community possible. And who knows, maybe we'll be back if there's interest and get to the things we didn't get to.